Hello, I'm Kim Corbin, and I'm continuing my series of sheltering in place interviews today. We're not going to be talking about sheltering in place, though. We're going to be talking about Black Lives Matter, just because I've been so moved by the deep change that's starting to happen in this country after the tragic murder of George Floyd. And so I asked my guest today, Rob Mack, who is a positive psychology expert and the author of Happiness from the Inside Out, to join me to have a conversation about just some things that have been coming up for me as I'm watching all of this unfold and just trying to be the best white ally that I can possibly be. So Rob, thank you so much for being here.
Thanks for having me, Kim. I'm so excited to connect with you again.
I know. It's been what year did your book come out?
Oh my gosh, I think it was like 2009 maybe.
Yeah, so we've been friends for a really long time and really happy to be here with you. And I thought just a good place to start would just be to get your general impressions or thoughts on what's unfolding on the global stage as far as Black Lives Matter goes.
Yeah, you know, I think it's really exciting in so many ways. And I think the idea is, you know, at the end of the day, the one thing we all care about, I think, is fairness and justice and equality. And, you know, at the end of the day, we've all had our own experiences. And, you know, I know I've heard plenty of my own experiences, and some of those experiences weren't happy or comfortable ones. And a lot of that was also, you know, based on my race. And so, you know, I'm as excited as anybody at the possibility and the opportunity that we'll continue to live and pre-pave a life that's lived from a place of justice and equality and, you know, just treating everybody, I think, with kindness and love. And compassion. I know that's a tall order for most of us, but you know, I'm excited about that. And I also understand lots of challenges there, right? Sometimes even just challenges with the language and the semantics and understanding where folks are coming from. And I think it can be a difficult time for most of us trying to find that common ground. But I do think there's an opportunity for us to all heal as a population, as a people.
Yes, amen. So my kind of entree into Black Lives Matter happened 4 years ago. It was right before the last election. And I was organizing an event, a free hugs event. And a friend of mine made a t-shirt that said, "Free Hugs Matter." And I took a picture of myself with it on and I proudly put it on Facebook. And I said, "Isn't this great?" And one of my friends very gently pointed out, you know, the Black Lives Matter people might not be that thrilled with you doing that. My initial reaction was defensiveness. Like, what do you mean? I'm promoting love. I'm promoting hugs. Like, what could possibly be wrong here? But I also was open-minded and I started talking to some Black friends about it. And everyone was so wonderful and gentle with me at the time to help me start to realize, like, I had heard of Black Lives Matter. And it's a perfect example of my white privilege that I'd heard of it, but I hadn't really paid that much attention to it. Because in my mind, I was like, I love Black people. I go to Glide. I have Black friends. I'm not racist. You know, I would never have thought that. So I never dove deeper into it. And then through this experience 4 years ago, I started to pay a little bit more attention about what was going on and what they were up to. And I realized that I shouldn't wear that shirt. And so it was really a soft and gentle introduction into all of this. And I'm so grateful that I had that before all of this unfolded, because unfortunately right now, it seems like there is not a lot of love and gentleness happening. When someone says all lives matter, it's like, ha, like they just get attacked. And, you know, like social media has gotten so out of control. So, and I think defensiveness as a white person is a natural reaction, because you don't think it applies to you. And really we're looking at a big systemic issue here that we are all a part of, whether we realize it or not. So especially as a positive psychologist, I'm curious what your thoughts are about kind of that defensiveness that comes up in yes. ourselves and in others, and how we can kind of navigate it.
Great question, Kim. And let me first of all commend and applaud you for being the incredibly generous and kind and flexible cognitively person that you are, because that's not always easy. You're right. I think our knee-jerk reaction anytime someone says that we're wrong or we're not exactly right is to be defensive and to, you know, get a little reactive. And so that's perfectly normal and human of us. And there's also a huge opportunity for us to then pivot from that place to a place that's a deeper understanding, right? So I want to commend you on that first. I think that the one thing that I've become increasingly clear about, and thank God I was blessed with some incredible like undergrad and graduate level psychology courses that spoke to the implicit bias that most of us share. Even, you know, people of color, you know, often have implicit bias against their own people, right? That, you know, if you're shown a picture of a fireman or something like that, initially our first gut reaction is it's probably going to be a white person. It's probably not going to be a colored person. And so we have these this implicit bias that plays out all the time. So there's that level. And then, you know, we often find that, you know, as they say, those things that we can't accept about ourselves or digest ourselves, we vomit up on other people, we project onto other people. And so sometimes we have a lot of that happening too. And that can happen, that happens to all of us. And it comes from all of us, no matter our color or race or gender or sexual orientation. You know, we experience all these things like projection, like the implicit bias. And so what I'm particularly fascinated with are those folks that somehow, some way through all of this, find ways to seek out common ground, seek out common understanding, and to flex their cognitive agility and their emotional regulation that allows for a safe, like psychologically safe and emotionally safe place to have these kind of conversations. Because at the end of the day, the one thing we know from lots of science is that mostly when we have these kinds of conversations about race or something that's very delicate or very sensitive or very challenging, we often end up more polarized as a result of having those conversations. And so much of that is because people on both sides of the table are so entrenched in their own beliefs and their own frustrations and their own assumptions, most of which are flawed, that when the other person even offers up an objective piece of data, they can't see all of it for what it is and they double down on their original beliefs. So there's a huge opportunity for folks like yourself and like me, again, no matter what race, color we are, to provide a psychological and emotional safe place of unconditional regard so that we can have conversations that actually move us forward and help to heal and bridge this polarization that we're experiencing both as a country, but also globally. I mean, it's just critically important. But I think we often overlook that part of it, this part that is all about projection, you know, this implicit bias there, the defensiveness, the reactivity, taking out on other people what we ourselves can't process or haven't processed or don't realize. So there's a lot of ego in all of this, right? And ego meaning, you know, essentially deep levels of unconsciousness, right? So it doesn't really matter who we are, but we all experience some of that.
Yes. And actually, that's a great, I wanted to bring in Eckhart Tolle's work about this, which is very much about helping us come to know our egos and recognize our egos, because it really, one of his main ideas is the pain body. And then when we're triggered and defensive or something's kind of got us out of our center and our presence, we're in our pain bodies. And that seems to be so much of what's going on out there in social media land, or when those biases get triggered, is it's two pain bodies battling instead of just taking a deep breath when you feel defensive and getting centered and then and being open.
Boom, you nailed it. And boy, do I love Eckhart, right? We all love Eckhart. And Kim, you are the OG there, PR around the Eckhart stuff. I mean, I love Eckhart. I love what he's saying there. And of course, that's precisely it. You know, and it's frustrating a little, because at the end of the day, the one thing I'm clear about is, you know, when I'm fighting any kind of fight or any kind of war, or better than that, I'm really focused on healing. I want as many allies as I can possibly have. So I'm gonna do whatever I can to recruit as many people onto my team of health and happiness and wellness and all that. And a lot of that means not shaming people into a place of making change. It doesn't mean judging people and hoping that that's going to lead to change. Generally, that doesn't work. What happens with most people is they have that knee-jerk reaction, double down on their original belief, and before you know it, they're more deeply entrenched in their unconsciousness. And one of the things that I've always loved about Eckhart that he says consistently around that pain body and unconsciousness is that, you know, to fight unconsciousness is unconscious. Like, it's unconsciousness itself. Or to fight ignorance is ignorance itself and stupidity itself. So that doesn't mean in any way it won't stand up for what we believe, but it does mean that there's a way to approach it so that we're coming from a place of higher consciousness or deeper consciousness so that we can actually not just inform people, but help the people to transform, right? We want to transform all of this, not just provide information that's going to be, you know, lost on deaf ears.
Absolutely. Yeah. And it's funny because I brought up in one of our weekly Zoom meetings from work that I was going to have this conversation with you, and how I'm really feeling called to try and bring love and consciousness into this conversation. And so when I told my coworker, she sent me a quote from Rachel Cargill, who's a popular anti-racism activist and educator. And she says, the easiest way for white women to skirt around the realities of racism is to just love and light it away. When confronted with ways they have offended a marginalized group with their words or actions, they immediately start to demand unity and peace, painting those they harmed as aggressive, mean, or divisive. I don't want your love and light if it doesn't come with solidarity and action. Mm-hmm. Spiritual bypass is a defense mechanism. Although the defense looks a lot prettier than other defenses, it serves the same purpose. Mm-hmm. And so I wrote back to her and I thanked her for sharing this with me. And I said that what I'm really trying to shine a light on here is the love along with solidarity, love and light with solidarity and action. And we need both to really be there. So I'd be curious your overall thoughts on that.
What to say there, Kim?
And I mean, spiritual bypassing, you know, just in general, like why that doesn't work, like how, you know, the difference there.
Yeah. So, you know, spiritual bypass to a large extent is really avoiding the real issue. It's not wanting to dive deeper and process and work through the underlying problem, right? So it's just a case, it's not even barely pruning the tree. But it's pruning the tree on some level, instead of going to the root of the tree and really help, you know, getting underneath in the ground of where the real root of the problem is. You know, and lots of us can fall victim to spiritual bypass. I think it's difficult to just blanket someone or something as spiritual bypass until you really know who they are and where they're coming from. Because Kim, you and I both know you've done this work for decades now, right? And it's like me, I've done the work for decades and I can do so many things not well at all. But there's a couple of things that I focus my life on. And so the spiritual bypass thing is a reality. And at the same time, you know, and Eckhart talks about this well too, there are folks that we need them that are frequency holders, right? And that doesn't mean that they don't take inspired action. Sometimes assertive, convicted, dedicated, committed, aggressive action, right? But they're taking it from a totally different place, where it's from an inspired place that's much more intelligent, much more creative, and much more transformative, right? And so the question, I don't think, is whether or not to take action or not, or whether or not to only talk love and light. It's about how can we talk love and light and be the love and light, and at the same time, take action from that place of love and light that can be just as assertive and just as, in fact, much more so, exponentially more transformative. And so there is a danger, of course, of just, you know, quote unquote, sort of skirting the issue, or, you know, avoiding the real issue and not wanting to deal with our own biases and our own, you know, shortcomings, so to speak. But I would also really strongly argue that if you want change to stick, then you've got to go deeper, and you've got to go deeper and help meet people where they are, which means being able to create a space of psychological and emotional safety, physical safety as well, that allows change to happen. I mean, I don't know about you, but I mean, I've been in the change business for 20 years. I thought I was getting into the people change business game. I was convinced, like, oh, I'm going to change people. And then you realize you can't just enforce or convince or legislate change all the time. Yes, you want to do what you can in terms of legislation, no question about it. But in terms of making people change, ideally, you want people to be inspired to change so they can see the ways in which it benefits them and benefits the world and benefits all of us in some way, right? And so that's a conversation that you can only have when you have access to psychological and emotional resources and capital, when you are filled with more love and more light. You cannot access those psychological and emotional resources and capital when you're feeling dark and depressed and upset and angry. Like, anger and being upset is very, it's initiating, right? So it lets you initiate action, but it doesn't sustain it. And so if we care about sustaining long-term change that's truly transformative, the fuel cannot only come from anger, it cannot only come from being upset, it cannot only come from being overwhelmed. It's also going to come from a place that's much deeper and that's much more long-lasting, right? And that's a place of higher consciousness or deeper consciousness. And so, yes, to all of it, and I know it's a lot to kind of weave in, but I would say that ultimately at the end of the day, you know, we don't want short-term change that is quickly buried under the next hot item or the next hot theme. You know, from a cultural perspective, we want something that's sustainable and long lasting.
Yes, yes. I have a great, and my next quote fits in so perfectly with what you just said. It's by an author named Layla Saad, and her book is called Me and White Supremacy. I just started a book club around this where it's 28 days of really looking at your own biases and stuff like that. And one of the things I've been noticing is that a lot of people in these groups that I've been participating in are really getting stuck in their guilt and shame about systemic racism and about what white people have done to black people, and kind of staying stuck or getting mired in the guilt and shame, which is important to feel. But eventually we need to be able to move to the love and light. So this quote from Layla says, you also need love for this journey, because when the truth telling gets really hard, you will need something more powerful than pain and shame to encourage you to keep going. Pain and shame are neither desirable nor sustainable as long-term strategies for transformational change. It is my hope that love is what initially brought you to this work. It is my conviction that love is what will keep you going.
I love that. I mean, beautiful, Kim. Like, and that's, I mean, it's just such a, and it reminds me too, you know, back like to the Martin Luther King Jr. quote, you know, he said, you know, darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Only light can drive out darkness. Like hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Only love can drive out hate. So the challenge here is we want to take massive action, and we want to take massively intelligent, creative action, sustainable action, long-term transformative action. But you've got to do that from a place where you're going to be most creative, efficient, effective, and efficacious at doing that. And that means when you're most dialed in to those psychological, emotional resources and capital. And Barbara Fredrickson, a positive psychologist, talks very eloquently about the ways in which when we come from a much more sort of positive and, dare I say, loving and peace-seeking place, we find that our perspective is broadened and we build on these psychological and emotional resources that we have, and we come up with solutions that instead of taking us all the way through the alphabet, take us straight to, from A to Z, right? And so much of what you're saying, Kim, is so helpful and so necessary for people to hear. You know, at the end of the day, the best fighter in the ring doesn't stay angry, right? There's something about that. You got to be able to slow yourself down. You don't fight from a place of anger all the time. And so, yes, we need the anger in the beginning. We need the frustration. We need to feel overwhelmed. That initiates the change. But in order to keep it going and to make sure that it sticks, we need something more than that.
One of the people that I love this in one of the groups that I'm in this week talked about that it's from a spiritual standpoint, we need to repent, but after repentance comes forgiveness.
Yeah.
And so that really resonated, you know, like, and I think that guilt and that shame is part of that repenting part of the process, but then eventually we must get to forgiveness so we can really join together.
Oh, totally. I mean, look, I grew up in a very small town, monolithic culture. Mostly it was just me and a couple other people of color, and I was surrounded, you know, mostly by white people, okay? And, you know, most of my experiences were somewhat pleasant, but there were days when we'd get to the school and in our lockers would be nooses or Confederate flags or whatever, you know? It was a pretty regular experience, and so much so that I eventually just said, I guess this is the way life is, you know? And it's interesting to me because not that I didn't have frustration, and of course I didn't, I had anger maybe at times and embarrassment or whatever, but I was generally just a pretty well-intentioned kid. You know, it doesn't mean that I was in any way a perfect kid, because I clearly wasn't, but I was well-intentioned. And so I wanted to be friends with everybody still, you know, like I just thought maybe they just were confused or maybe I was confused or whatever. And I will say that over the course of my life, and I've had plenty of run-ins with cops as well, okay? Like a lot of run-ins with cops. I mean, my brother and I were getting pulled over almost every other day when I first moved to Los Angeles. And I will say that I've found that people tend to at least entertain a competing narrative when you're coming from a place of trying to seek common ground and you're trying to work collaboratively together and you're using empathy. It works much more effectively than if I were to get upset and yell or whatever, you know, and there's time for that too. There's a time and place for that too. But I agree with you, Kim, like at the end of the day, there are some resources that we have available that we all have available that can actually help us achieve our goals much more quickly and much more easily than what maybe as a society or as a global population we've traditionally used, like let's say violence.
Yeah, yeah. So really it all comes back to that elevating and shifting our consciousness and bringing it back to love and compassion and collaboration.
Absolutely, absolutely. I mean, and if you look at that, I mean, I think that's when I've been most inspired by anybody else in the world. I'm most inspired by those people who can fight the good fight if and when they need to, okay? But they're fighting from a totally different place where they're centered, they're balanced, they're focused, they're clear, they're confident, and they're largely at peace on the inside. And that doesn't mean they're not gonna knock you out if they have to, right? They do what they have to do, but it's from a totally different place. And it's a place that is more focused on long-term change than just short-term change and trying to, you know, basically shame or judge people into doing something differently.
Yeah. And I've been reminded a lot of when the fires happened here. And as soon as that happened, everyone wanted to jump in and everyone wanted to be a part of it and everyone wanted to help. And it's great, but this is 400 years of programming that we're beginning to dismantle now. And so it's really a marathon and not a sprint. And that's also part of this deep lasting change that we're creating.
So well said, Kim. Virtue signaling. So what you see a lot these days is virtue signaling, right? So you got the influencers, and so many of them, I have to really commend them. So many of them are completely, fully, truly, deeply bought in on fairness, equality, on the Black Lives Matter movement. It is pure, it was so awe-inspiring. I get emotional about it. So incredible, right? And there's a ton of virtue signaling, right? So people that for lots of reasons, maybe they've been shamed into it, maybe they feel judged about it, maybe they know that they can find ways to broaden their brand or something. They're just advertising this virtue of being a great person or being part of the journey along with this Black Lives Movement thing. And so you get a lot of that, okay, especially when folks are feeling so much pressure, and you get a lot of that in the short term, but in the long term, you know, again, that's the question, Kim. So I love what you're saying there. You're sort of right, spot on right there.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, may we continue the work together.
Indeed. Indeed.
Yeah. And I really appreciate you taking the time to be here with me and process with me and just for being who you are.
Kim, you're a star. You know, I love you. Appreciate you so much.
I love you too.